So we
good evening, हम लोग खा
रहे हैं। Good evening, students. Okay. Have a look at the board.
Last term.
Have a look at the board. Okay. When you look at the board, you will see that. You will see that I have drawn a rough sketch. I have drawn a rough sketch of the lower part of the country. Okay, in order to explain you. In order to explain you, okay, the agencies. In order to explain you the factories, the agencies that were under the British, and we see that these were the important ports. These were the important ports: Cambay, Surat, Bombay, okay, Karwar, okay, Kannanore, and then you have Masulipatnam, okay, Visakhapatnam, okay. This is the anglicized version of the word Visakhapatnam. These were the important port, okay. These were the important ports, and they have, okay, a special importance as far as the British administration was concerned. We know that the first factory, that the first factory was set up at Hooghly. The first factory was set up at Hooghly in Bengal, okay. And we see that these are the important places. Serampore is there, Chandernagore is there. So we see that the Carnatic region is there, okay. This is the Carnatic region, and we know that the French and the British, they were involved in Anglo-French rivalry, and the Anglo-French rivalry, it lasted for nearly 40 years. It lasted nearly for 40 years, and we see that they were fighting for this Carnatic region, and this Carnatic region was famous for the cultivation of spices like paper and cardamom. And we see that the Carnatic region was famous for the cultivation of spices, and it was also well known for sandalwood. But we see that the rulers of this place, they were not interested in doing trade with the foreigners, and we see which led to clash of interest between the French and the British, and it was finally the British who were victorious, and they were able to have a hold on these regions. So we see that of all the European powers, of all the European trading companies, the Danish trading companies, the Portuguese, okay, the French, the British, it were the British, okay, who proved themselves victorious in having a control of the different territories of the country. Now we will try to understand the situation in Bengal. I studied yesterday, okay, and we studied that the three villages, the British, they were able to secure the trading rights of, they got the jamindari right of three villages of Bengal. Okay, the British were able to secure the zamindari rights of three villages. Three villages of Bengal, and these villages were Sutakanti, okay. We see that it was Sutanati, Kalikatta, and okay, Gobindpur. These were the three important villages. Okay, we see that these were the important villages of which the jamindari rights they secured, and we also saw that they persuaded the rulers. They persuaded the rulers to give them concessions as far as trading rights were concerned. Okay, and we see all this was happening, but as far as the as far as the Bengal was concerned, we see that through the early 18th century, the conflict between the Bengal, the Nawabs of Bengal and the, when we go through the heading, how trade led to battles. We see, okay, though the British were able to secure, okay, trading rights and concessions by bribing the officials. We see that though they were able to, okay, secure the trading rights and concessions by bribing the officials, okay, yet they failed to influence the rulers, okay? They failed to influence the native rulers, okay? And we will see this when we will go through the history of Bengal. When we will go through the history of Bengal, we will see that the state of Bengal was ruled by different rulers. First by Murshid Quli Khan, then Sujauddin, and after Sujauddin, it was Aliwardi Khan. Okay, so we see that the Bengal Nawabs we see that Bengal was ruled by, okay, rulers like Murshid Quli Khan, Sujauddin, and Aliwardi Khan. So we see that these were the important Nawabs. These were the important Nawabs of Bengal, and these Nawabs, we see that the Nawabs, okay, they were having conflict with the company officials. They were having conflict with the East India Company. And what was the reason of conflict? Okay. The reason of conflict was that the Bengal Nawabs, we see that the conflict between the Nawabs and the company intensified. We see that the conflicts between the Nawabs of Bengal and the company intensified. Okay. During the early 18th century. There were a lot of reasons. There were a lot of reasons for this conflict. Okay, we will try to understand a few of the reasons. As far as Aliwardi Khan was concerned, Aliwardi Khan wanted the company officials. Okay, Aliwardi Khan, okay, laid down two rules. As far as Aliwardi Khan was concerned, Aliwardi Khan laid down two rules for the company to follow. Okay? and he wanted the company to follow these rules. If the company denied to follow these rules, then the company would lose the trading rights in Bengal. Okay, his main motive was that the company should follow these rules, and if the company fails to or denies to follow these rules, the company should the company should give up the trading rights in Bengal. Okay, what were these trading the two rules were that the officials, there were certain officials, the company officials who were in private trade, apart from following the interest of the company, there were some company officials who were engaged in private trade. These company officials who were engaged in private trade shall pay customs duty. Or they will lose the privilege if they are not paying, or the privilege of not paying the duty will be withdrawn together. If they are paying the customs duty, fine. If they are not paying the customs duty, the privilege of not paying the duty will be withdrawn altogether. So they will be not enjoying any kind of privileges if they are not paying the duties. So the paying of customs duty was a must for these officials who were engaged in private trade under the East India Company. Now the second one was, the company shall not extend its fortification. The company shall not extend its fortification In a previous session, we studied about the factories, and we came to know that factories were the places, factories were the warehouses where the goods were kept, where the goods of the company were stored, and it were the places where the company officials were stationed. These the East India Company, it pressurized the rulers, the native rulers, to give them concessions at different points of time, and they utilized these privileges, the concessions, the concessions, and they tried setting up forts. They tried setting up forts, factories, and these factories, were fortified. So the rulers were against this, against any kind of fortification. So we see that these were the two rules that were asked to be followed by the company, by Aliwardi Khan. But we see that the company refuses to follow these, rules, and we see by the end of the 18th century, we see that the company has become strong. We see that the company has become strong, and they are not in a mood. The company has become strong, and they are not in a mood to listen to the Bengal Nawabs. The Nawabs of Bengal, we see that the Nawabs of Bengal refused. The Bengals of Nawab refused to grant the company when you are not ready to listen to me, why should I abide by you? This was the reason behind the steps that were taken by the Bengal Nawabs. The Nawabs of Bengal refused to grant concessions. They refused to grant concessions. Okay. Demanded large tributes. They began demanding large tributes from the company officials. Demanded large tributes for the company's right to trade. Okay, they also denied, the Bengal Nawabs also denied the company the right to mint coins. We see that, as far as the state of Bengal, as far as the territory of Bengal was concerned, it was one of the greatest landmarks as far as the setting up of British administration of India, British administration in India is concerned. We see that the company, the East India Company had to import gold and silver. Had to import gold and silver from Britain in order to buy goods in India. So the company, they wanted these native rulers, they especially the Nawabs of Bengal, to allow them to mint the coins, to utilize the gold and silver to mint the coins. But the Bengal Nawabs, they refused, they denied the company the right to mint coins. This was also one of the causes of conflict, and it also, the Nawabs also stopped the company from further from extending its fortification so you see, one after the other, the company officials, the East India Company was restricted in its activities, in its performance by the Nawabs of Bengal, because the East India Company was not giving them the due respect, which they should be getting, and the company was also misusing its authority. It was misusing its authority. It was bribing the officials. It was manipulating the prices as far as the trading of goods was concerned, buying of goods was concerned, and it was also exploiting. It was also exploiting the what? The sellers, the traders. So the company, the Bengal Nawabs, they had a strict watch. They were strictly observing the activities of these the East India Company, and they were not in a mood. They were not in a mood to allow any kind of freedom. Allow any kind of freedom to these trading companies like the East India Company to extend its fortification and to utilize the resources of the country for their betterment. We see that apart from this, the Bengal Nawabs, apart from these restrictions, the Bengal Nawabs, they accused the company of writing. They also accused the company of writing ओके डिसरेस्पेक्टफुल लेटर्स and trying to humiliate the Nawab and his officials so we see that in the field of trade a kind of war is being carried out okay a kind of war okay is being carried out and previously this war was a mental war okay and with passage of time the situation got worsened day by day and we see that due to this conflict of opinions due to this conflicting interest okay the conflict of interest both from the Nawab side and from the company side we see that the situation worsened and it finally led to the okay battle okay these were the allegations that were put forward by the Nawabs okay the company too had the company was also not satisfied with the behavior of the Bengal Nawabs we see that the Nawabs accused the British of not paying the taxes okay as far as trade was concerned they were not paying the okay duties and they were not paying the taxes but we see that the company too had allegations against the Nawab and what were these allegations the company on its part declared that the company on its part declared that the unjust demands of the Nawabs and his officials were ruining okay were ruining the company's trade okay so the company has allegations too the company had allegations too against these Nawabs and we see that the company on its part declared that the unjust demands of the Nawabs and his officials were ruining the company's trade okay and okay the company believed that trade could flourish the company believed that trade could flourish only if the duties were removed so we see one side the Nawabs are demanding okay demanding the company to pay the taxes okay to pay the tributes and on the other hand we see that the company is not ready to pay any kind of okay tribute is not ready to pay any kind of duties as far as trade was concerned so we see that the company was convinced. Okay, the East India Company was convinced that to expand trade it had to enlarge its settlements and by what by new villages so these were the remarks that were put forward by the company as far as trade was concerned. So we see these are the conflicting interests. The Nawabs are interested in something else and the company is interested in their own benefit. The company is interested in its own progress. So due to this, the situation got worsened and we see that finally finally we see that a lot of changes are taking place as far as Bengal is concerned, and we see that Aliwardi Khan died in the year 1756. He died in the year 1756, and we see that Sirajuddaula, his grandson, becomes the Nawab of Bengal, and like his grandfather Sirajuddaula was also having a strict check. He was also keeping a strict check on the activities of the British. He too was not ready to give any kind of trade concessions to the British. And he wanted the British to stop its fortifications, but the British denied the demands that were put forward by the Nawab. And we see that we see that Sirajuddaula, he was well aware of the activities of the British. He was very much familiar with the activities of the British. He demanded them to pay tribute the taxes and the tributes okay He also ordered them. He also ordered them to stop the fortification of Fort William. Okay, and we see that he was infuriated. He was infuriated with the activities of the British. The British were meddling in the administrative affairs. He strictly ordered the British not to meddle. The word meddle means not to interfere in the administrative affairs of the kingdom. So he was aware of the activities of the company, and so he is demanding a lot of things. He is demanding a lot of things to be followed by the company officials. He demands them to pay the taxes and the tributes which are to be paid to a ruler. And since he was the Nawab of Bengal, he has the right to be given tribute by the company officials. He also stopped them from extending their fortification, especially the fortification of Fort William, which was one of the important base of the British in Bengal. He also ordered them not to meddle, not to interfere in the administrative affairs of the administration. But we see that the British, we see that the British, they were able to influence the nobles. They were able to influence the nobles and the Nawabs who were against the Nawab of Bengal, that is Sirajuddaulah. And with passage of time, we see that by bribing the officials, by creating greed among these officials, that they will give them a lot of money after defeating the Nawab. They were able to win over the support of the nobles and the officials that were working under the Nawab of Bengal, that is Sirajuddaulah. And as you go through the chapter, you'll come across one of the important officials of the Nawab, that is Mir Jafar. You will come across the instance where Mir Jafar, he refuses to fight for the Nawab, that is Sirajuddaulah, and this eventually led to the defeat of the Nawab in the Battle of Plassey, which was fought in the year 1757. We will cover the Battle of Plassey and Battle of Buxar in our next class.